and welcome to the Sunset Safari, the only place in the entire world where you can sit from the comfort of your home or work or wherever you happen to be commuting to or from and watch a live safari in the middle of the African bush. Now, my name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have Viam on camera with me, and we're heading to investigate the southern boundary of our traverse area. We come to you live from several different properties from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. We're going to be exploring Cheetah Plains, I think, this afternoon, see what else we can find. Not only are we live, but we're also interactive, which means you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And let us see what we can investigate for you on this somewhat windy afternoon out here in the Sabi Sands. It's warm-ish. I'm not quite sure I would describe it as warm, but it's warm-ish with a distinct feeling of a cold front on the way, the berg winds howling around. And also, I know that Brent touched upon that, upon this morning, but we think that there is a large fire somewhere in our, not necessarily close vicinity, but in our vicinity, because it's incredibly smoggy at the moment. So whilst I haven't heard any reports of such things, I'm busy looking at a track that is not actually an exciting track at all. In fact, it is a zebra track, and it's not even a very clear zebra track. But I thought for a second it might be Tingana. And the reason I thought it might be Tingana is from what pieces of the puzzle we gained this morning on the Sunrise Safari. It appears as though Tingana killed an Inyala on the northern side of Juma. He was then very hastily sent scurrying away by the presence of the Birmingham boys and the Nkuhumas that were with James first thing on the Sunrise Safari, munching away on, we suspect, we'll never know, but we suspect Tingana's Nyala kill. He then came racing back to the south, spurred on by possibly the threat of lions, but also spurred on by the presence of numerous elephants. We've had huge elephant herds around. A particularly pleasant afternoon sighting yesterday with afterwards what I counted must have been about 70, maybe 80 elephants, all closely packed together around Treehouse Dam. We're going to leave Brent to investigate that, and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that in a moment. We're going to leave Brent to investigate whether or not the Nkuhumas or the Birminghams are still in that area. We're going to check the southern boundary to see if Tingana perhaps thought it was a good idea to come sneaking back on. Basically, keeping our fingers crossed, and then of course there's always the possibility of Karula, the leopard. So Tingana is the dominant leopard of this area, dominant male leopard. Karula is nicknamed the Queen of Juma, and she's a female leopard that's very much based in this particular area. She has two brand new cubs. Now, for those of you who've been watching us over the last few days, you're aware of something of our vehicle woes. Wendy, during a lion sighting, whilst I watched the Nkuhuma lioness disappear north up the road, stalled and probably never started again. The wonderful news is that we have two mechanics who have come in specially to help us sort out the various issues that we have been having with the vehicles, and they've been frantically working on her. She is up and running. She just needs one or two minor finishing touches before she is all ready to go. So Brent and Brian will be out a little bit later. Our sort of temporary solution of the backpack strapped to the Mahindra and then the camera tripod strapped to the front of the Mahindra was a good idea while it lasted, but that also unfortunately stopped working. As you can imagine, there's all kinds of technological and mechanical implications involved in bringing a live safari to you. So much so that I'm going to stop and show you your first heartbeat of the day. Admittedly, on a power... No, I'm not. I'm sorry. I'm not going to show you your first heartbeat because unfortunately, as we move away from this lilac-breasted roller, there's somebody who would like to come along behind us. Here we go. Not too difficult. We just shuffle off the road. Oh, we've been causing quite the traffic jam. Oops. That's one vehicle, two vehicles, three vehicles, and one stunning lilac-breasted roller. At least they all seem relatively friendly. Oh, four vehicles. That's funny. And I bet they all got very excited until they realized that we were looking at a lilac-breasted roller. Not that there's anything wrong with the lilac-breasted roller. So pleasant to have this camera back on board once again, and it brings me, as these cars, let me just settle for a moment, let them carry on, because otherwise Viam and myself are going to sneeze our way through the rest of the drive thanks to the dust, and we'll have to repeatedly clean his lens. So we're going to sit here for a moment. This weather is difficult for game viewing, particularly with this amount of wind and also sort of with this level of smog and haze around. A lot of things are hiding away. It brings me to an idea that I've had, and I'm hoping that I keep looking behind the camera, and that's because there's two batelier. Unfortunately, they're very, very tricky to see. Oh, wait, hold on, the male's going to be kind enough to fly overhead. There he goes. The distinctive shape of a batelier in flight. Unmistakable. Sideways rocking. Very, very short tail. Unpredictable movements. And then, of course, what tells me it is a male is the half black and half white underneath the wings. Females have much more white underneath than black. There's two of them fluttering about, but there's only one that we can see at the moment. And what actually alerted me to their presence was the cawing call that they were making to communicate with each other, a kind of a caw sound. So thank you, bateliers, for keeping us here. We're going to continue on now that the vehicles have moved away and we don't have to deal with quite the dust cloud that we did before. So what I was going to say before the batelier very kindly came into view was that I think it's time to challenge Brent to a competition myself. The last time we drove together, Brent challenged me to a mammal competition, and I think he decided that we tied. I'm pretty sure I won, but he's convinced that we tied somehow. And the competition was to see how many mammals we could get on camera. Oh, I think it's time to return the favor. I promised to do it, but then the next morning I completely forgot. So I have remembered, and since we are faced with some interesting weather conditions this afternoon, once, and the competition will only start once Brent goes out, and I'm a lot better at laying the ground rules, so let's do it like this. Every sighting that we have, that we stop for, whether it is a tree or a bird or a mammal, we are going to give the most interesting anecdote, not fact, anecdote, that we have about that particular thing. And I'm laying down this competition knowing that 100% there's a good chance that Brent is going to win, given his background essentially growing up in the African bush his entire life. I've spent a couple of years, Brent has spent most of his life out here. So I'm laying down the ground rules knowing that Brent has an advantage. I've got a better camera with me though, so you know, that kind of evens the playing field. And then you lot watching at home can judge which one out of all of the anecdotes. You can only give one, you have to pick your best anecdote about that sighting. And you can judge by the end of the drive which of us came up with the best anecdote. And it's entirely up to you how you define best. It can be the funniest, it can be the most interesting, can be the scariest. Whatever you feel engaged you the most, that will be the competition for today. I haven't told Brent I'm doing this, so that lucky job will be Kirsten's. Kirsty in final control, who apparently has already passed on that particular message. So we have Kirsty and Jerry in final control this afternoon, and they will be directing your show and passing through your wonderful questions. Let us see if Brent feels up to rising to that challenge or not. He is out on Wendy with Brian. Let's head across there.
Welcome to Safari Live. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have my fellow partner in crime, Brian Joubert, and his thumb on drive, and of course, sometimes we're known as the killer bees. We weren't killing the cats this morning, I'm afraid, but we are going to try now. So James let me in on a secret where the Inyala kill was. So we're just gonna come have a little look, see? And I think it was just in here this morning. And I hear Jamie has challenged us to an anecdote competition. That is quite interesting. I don't think I've ever competed in an anecdote competition before, but I shall try my best, and it's going to be a difficult one to start with an anecdote. Oh, very funny that. I wonder if this was Master Hendry or some other numpty who managed to fall into a very big hole and looks like they got stuck. I really hope that was James. But moving on. Now, an anecdote about an Inyala carcass. Oh dear, this is not as easy as I thought it was going to be. I'm trying to make sure that there isn't a lioness sleeping somewhere around. The vultures have been here, so no. Okay, here we go. That is what very little remains. And hopefully as I get out of the car, I don't get growled at. Very little remains of a big male Inyala. Now, it's very fresh. So what we think happened here, quite interestingly, just from the tracks, is actually Tingana made this kill and the lion stole it from him. So we've done some following up. But lions definitely did not pick the bones clean, that clean at least anyway. And even a lot of the sinew, and that has been picked out of between there. And if you look carefully around, there's some little feathers, some downy feathers, and white spots of bird feces. So the vultures have come here, and that does remind me of an anecdote. Once upon a time, in the far eastern Kruger National Park, we were sitting with a crowd of lions around a big kill, and a very new safari guide drove and parked under a tree. And it was very hot, and he looked very confused why the rest of us were viewing the lions from the blistering sun. And we found out shortly, we just smiled and nodded at him. And then the little imp on my shoulder may or may not have decided I should drive towards his tree, flushing what was in the tree. And him and his guests may or may not have been defecated on by white-backed vultures. So you can see, for a vulture, even a big vulture, it's quite difficult for them to get through the skin, especially here, it's quite thick, but they will eat the ears off, and that has been done on both occasions here. And oh, carrion beetles already inside, but if we turn this around, here we go, you can see that part of the skin there was probably removed by the lions, and the vultures have used that to get right into the eye sockets. And you can see this one, they can get into the eye there, eye is completely gone. It's always a good sign that vultures have fed off a carcass, or batelier for that matter, if the eyes are gone but the skin on the face is still intact. Now, I thought, because there's a little bit of meat left, not much, the lionesses might still be around when you arrive, but unfortunately not. There we go. We've seen that Nyala's lovely tail before when it has been attached. And there it is now. So that white, when they alarm call, when they spot something, they lift up the tail. But I don't want all the ticks that are trying to remove themselves from the Nyala to climb onto me. There we go. So we've got to think now, there's two possibilities where these lions could have gone, because there's water in two places. So there's water at the Gallagher waterhole, and there's water at Sydney's waterhole. Sydney's is a little bit closer, and the other lions went that direction this morning. So it's probably the next best spot to go check. And I was really hoping as I jumped out of the car that I'd growl at me, because then at least we would have had lions. Is okay. Let's go check towards the waterhole. And we're not going to make the same mistake that someone else did and reverse into that very large hole. We shall tactfully maneuver ourselves between the remains of the Nyala, rather. Oh, there we go. Big male Nyala. Definitely quite old, probably slightly towards the end of its life. But unfortunate for Mr. Tingana, he managed to catch it when the lions were about. Now, we're not very happy with those lions, because if they hadn't have arrived, Mr. Tingana would have probably still been around here. So although lions are not dependent on water, if it's available, they will take advantage of it. So James Richard would like to check if the jackal pair is around. Says he'd enjoy to hear an anecdote about them. This is going to be an interesting anecdotal safari. Maybe a first for me. So if we get no luck and no tracks heading up this way, then we might check around the Gallagher waterhole. So the rest of the lions, the four Birminghams, and from what I could hear, a single lioness, went into the Manuletti this morning. So they have departed. They could always come back this evening, or maybe even come back earlier. They might have come back for a drink at Sydney's during the day. And we'll find out shortly. Just checking for tracks. So while we go investigate further the possibility of some lions, Jamie has got a spotted bird.
I have one of my favorite spotted birds with me, and an anecdote that is all prepared for you as part of our competition. Now here we have the helmeted guinea fowl, and I've just realized I have two anecdotes now to choose between, and I have to pick the best one and keep the other up my sleeve, pecking away at the grass seeds. Now they're entirely ground-based birds, but at night, or if threatened by a leopard or something similar, they fly up and they roost in sort of densely vegetated trees that keep their leaf cover, something like a jackalberry, for example. just trying to think, maybe, yes, I think let's go forward. We might have a slightly better view. And then we shall continue with the story. And this story comes from the very beginning of my guiding career. The very first time I was ever put in charge of a camp that we used to run on occasions, that was very much in the middle of nowhere. Now, we're kind of in the middle of the nowhere here, but this was really, truly in the middle of the nowhere. It was 3 hours from the nearest big city, and it was 3 hours hard driving to a place called Polokwane. We were up right near the Botswana-Zimbabwe border, and I just started out as a guide. It was the first time I was running the camp all by myself, and I had two lovely young German volunteers with me on the back. And we'd had the most incredible night of sightings. We'd had African wildcat, we'd had brown hyena, we'd had a porcupine with a baby. And I was feeling most elated and quite proud of myself that I'd managed to get them all of these sightings. And I stopped the vehicle that I was driving in as we were going home one night because I could feel that there was something that I'd heard rustling in the tree, and I had the spotlight and I couldn't see anything into it. Eventually I convinced myself that I was on such a roll, let me get out of the car and investigate what was making that noise in the dark. And the next thing, as I walked up to this tree, I was bombarded by a guinea fowl making an escape. I'd obviously disturbed them whilst they were sleeping because they're not totally silent. They shuffle and they cluck and they make a little bit of a noise, rustle the leaves a little bit, but not enough that I realized or worked out what they were. And it was the most undignified scream that I gave as about 20 guinea fowl came hurtling out of the tree, promptly doing what frightened birds at the same time, and thus ended what had previously been an exceptionally enjoyable game drive. And we took the volunteers home, and at that point it was just the way that we used to run the camp. It was just us, it was usually one person, sometimes two or more, but it was usually one staff member and just the group of guests, and we all lived together in one house out there. And let me just tell you that it was a very, very silent dinner on my behalf as I sort of nursed my bruised dignity and slightly devastated at the embarrassment that I had suffered. And as I said, this is at the beginning of my guiding career, not a mistake I would ever have made now. If it did happen to me now, I would have been able to deal with it a lot better. But at that point, I was most miserable. And then, of course, the next day I went to fix a flat tire, not change it, fix it. And you had these old tire arms that you had to pull down to get the tire off the rim and get to the tube inside. And it fell down and bashed me on the head, and I don't actually remember the rest of that day. I did take a game drive though, apparently. Sorry guys, back on the main road. We're just gonna let this gentleman go past. How's it? Looks very happy. So there we go, anecdote number one, the sleeping guinea fowl night. And one day we should actually combine, between all of us as presenters, we should combine all of our different bizarre experiences that we've had in the bush into one giant and probably usually hilarious novel. We'll get James to write it. We are going to go through the Mulwanini now, which is one of the largest drainage lines in this area. It's where Tundi was found two days ago by James. But we do occasionally have patchy signal as we make our way down into that drainage. While we do go through this little bit of a shaky patch, let's head on to Wendy.
So we are now sure there are no lions at Sydney's waterhole. There might be later on as it gets darker, so we'll try again. And I think we'll go meander away across to Arethusa. I haven't been there in a while. See what's happening in the west. Who knows? Maybe Anderson's about. So for those of you not sure who about Anderson is the biggest male leopard I have ever seen in my life. And I've seen quite a fair number of leopards in my days. His territory just touches in on the western side of Arethusa. And Tingana is the eastern Arethusa. So it's almost ridiculous, because when I mention the word leopard, it seems like there might be one on the other end.
Oh, you know, I said that James found Tundi here, and we've just found Tundi here. Oh, we've got to be exceptionally careful, nice and still, no sudden movements, no loud breathing, just in case we interrupt the signal. But we do have a sleeping leopard in a glorious tamburti on a termite mound. Isn't she absolutely gorgeous? There's also one very angry squirrel, which confuses me, because that squirrel must surely have known that the leopard was there, and maybe not. Maybe it got taken by surprise, went to run up to one of its regular holes and discovered that there was a large spotted cat lying up, draped as only a leopard can drape, across the branches of the tamburti tree. Unfortunately, I know that there's a big branch in the way of her face. And by the way, I don't actually know if this is Tundi. Really hard to tell, because she's far away and I can't see her. And if I reposition, I run the risk of losing signal. That being said, I think that there is a strong likelihood that it is her. She did have a kill up this tree a couple of days ago. And we suspect, we don't know, but we suspect that our lovely Tundi might actually be pregnant. We saw her mating exactly the right amount of time ago with Tingana. So hard to tell. Is this her? Seems likely. You just have an automatic affection for certain animals, and there's something about Tundi that I really enjoy. I don't know if it's her size. She is incredibly tiny. Very, very small female, and I think, I don't know what it is, I think it's maybe just the connection to Karula and Shadow as well, the likeness that she shares. But she's just this sort of perfect halfway mixture between Karula and Shadow in terms of looks. So we started off our drive talking about Karula, the Queen of Juma. This is her oldest daughter. And Karula has given the eastern part of her territory to Tundi and the western part of her territory to Tundi's twin sister Shadow, which I feel is, I mean, it doesn't always work like that, of course, with female leopards, but it's such a perfect example of the way in which female leopards do not disperse terribly far from their mothers. Oh, just can't quite get a good enough look at her face. It's a female, definitely, and it makes the most sense. It is the exact same tree, isn't it, Viam?
And same spot.
It's the same tree in the same spot that she was in last time. So that makes total sense that it is her. I think it's highly unlikely that it's any other leopard. And yes, Paul, this is indeed the same tree that James found her in. And it seems as though we've had just slightly better luck in terms of as long as I in a way, simply trying not to. There you go, Via. Leopard for you within the first now number one for the sunset safari.
Cheetah today, we agreed.
Yes, we did. We did agree we were doing cheetah today. We would like to film a different side as well as the leopard. And there will come a time where we do have to shift and move. I think there is another vehicle at some point. No, sorry, there isn't another vehicle. The groaning I hear is Rusty attempting to roll us down the hill. I'm just notching up the handbrake a few notches and try and get us to stay exactly where we are. And Tim, reminding me of our challenge, Tim has said we need a leopard anecdote. The difficulty here, Tim, is that there are so many leopard anecdotes that I'm trying to decide which one to choose from, which one will be the most interesting. I did say that the anecdotes don't have to be something that some of you haven't heard from us before, because of course we tell different stories every time we go out on drive, and at some point, eventually, we are going to run out of stories to tell. Luckily, we keep making them as we go along. So Tim, I'm trying to decide. There's two particular instances that I want to talk about, and I'm trying to decide which one I want to talk about, which one I want to tell you, because I did say you could only choose one. That's what makes this game or this challenge difficult. And I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to tell you about two different leopards that, or three different leopards that you guys have never met and never seen before, but a leopard that where I used to work I knew as well as we now know Karula, and her name was Rulani, and it was Rulani's cubs were the first leopard cubs I ever saw in my entire life. Rulani was beautifully relaxed. She was an absolutely amazing leopard to be around, and the first time I ever saw her cubs, I named them Artemis and Athena, two little cubs of about 4 months old gambling in a marula tree. And the one, they were both females actually, but the one was much more bold and adventurous than the other, as we've often spoken about with leopard cubs, and it kept tumbling out of the marula tree that it had climbed up into. And it would climb right up and then realize it couldn't get down and then fall out, sort of half tumble, half climb out, and then make the exact same mistake again, like she was practicing. And she eventually was named Rukia, and they didn't like my Artemis and Athena name, but fair enough, okay. And she moved into one of the lodges. So there were enormous floods a couple of years ago in this particular reserve, and while she was setting up her territory, the lodges were washed away, and the rooms all emptied, and the lodges were closed for, I think it was about 6 months. And during that time, she set up her home in room number 3 of Camp 3. And that was where she lived, on the guest's balcony. But then, of course, when the guests came back, they arrived back one afternoon from game drive after the lodge had been reopened, and Rukia had placed an entire impala on their balcony, which they found slightly distressing, I think, at the time. But Rulani was a mother to me. I don't know, it was just because I knew her as well as I did. But Rulani to me, I think, was my favorite leopard there. She was the one that we got to know the best, and she was kind of like the equivalent of our Karula. And she was also exceptionally successful as a mother. And we worked a lot with Panthera. So we got, even though we didn't see it was much harder to track in that area, it was just rocks. There was no sand, it was just rocks. So even though we didn't see her as often as we see Karula, we did work a lot with Panthera, and we did have camera traps up absolutely everywhere. So motion-triggered cameras. And we used to get a really nice idea of exactly where her territory was, and then watched as her cubs grew up and took over parts of her territory. The second one, the blue-eyed cub, we hardly ever saw her, and we actually ended up not giving her a name. We think she survived. We know she got seen every now and again, but she was the more timid of them, and she never really got used to people. As soon as mom was away and as soon as she dispersed, she just stayed skittish, unlike her sister. It was an interesting little experience. It was the first time I'd ever watched leopard cubs from not quite birth, but from babies to adults, and then having cubs of their own. There you go, my leopard anecdote, and that was a difficult one because I was also going to talk about Shadow's previous cub, Sindile, and of course you all know that he is wandering about the Sabi sands, constantly on the move, which I think was to be expected. But I was also thinking about telling the anecdote, and I'm not including this in the competition, but I just want to share it with you anyway. So Tundi, in front of us, her nephew, actually play-stalked me the one day while I was on foot tracking him. Followed me all the way back to the car. Remember that, Viam? I sort of started calling Viam at one point. I thought I should maybe get the vehicle in, because whilst it was a playful stalk, and he was very small, I just thought it would be sensible to alert Viam to the situation. Do you know what's funny about this sighting as well? Our poor four vehicles of guests that drove past. None of them, they all stopped for our lilac-breasted roller, but they never stopped for the leopard. I missed her completely. To be fair, she isn't all that easy to spot, but she's not exactly hidden either. And she isn't exactly the same tree. Ellen Fowler, welcome as always to our sunset safari. You're wondering, do I think she has a kill in the tree? I know she did. Viam, can we have a look? Oh no, that's her tail. Never mind. Sorry, that's her, the tip of her tail. Ellen, I know she did, but I think I remember it being reported as a Dacre kill. And I'm not sure if she has stashed it in this tree or if she's stashed it in another tree and she's just lying up away from the kill to get away from the flies and so on. Maybe let's have a look at the next option for hoisting, which I think will be the next largest Tamburti here. Let's just see if we can't. I can't move, Ellen, as you know, just because we will lose signal completely, and I don't want to do that since we have been doing so well. Let's try and investigate here. I mean, as you know, if it was a Dacre kill, and I could be corrected on that, my memory might be faulty, but it was something that I read up on one of the social media sites. But if she did have a kill, and it was a Dacre, they don't really last all that long. We've seen Karula eat a Steenbok in less than half an hour, from top to tail. A Dacre, unless Tundi was full when she caught it. The Dacre's not going to keep her busy. But that was only 2 days ago, so perhaps there is a little bit left. Scott would like to know, do leopards have favourite trees in which they sleep? And in my experience, we have different species of trees. A jackalberry, unfortunately, our signal is breaking up. I'm sure that Brent can field that question for me. We're going to send you back across to Brent and go off in search of some cheetah for VM to film.
Welcome back. We decided to just have a quick look in this area before crossing Zarathustra. Copy. Okay, so on Thursday, I spent the whole day walking in this area with Joffers and Yanni, and we were tracking Shadow and Cub. And they got unfortunately chased by elephants, but I think they might still be in this area. So we just want to check very carefully here. And see if there are any tracks. If there are, Herbert is with me again, and I'll leave Herbert with the radio and send him off into the bush after leopards for us. Sorry, I'm just listening to the radio quickly. Ah, no. Unfortunately, outside of our traverse area. So we're going to keep moving through here. And I was also hoping to catch up with some of the eddies we were with this morning. There are some tracks around here, but I haven't heard elephants for a while. Okay, always check on top of the big termite mounds, and leopards love to lie on top of them, and we're hoping to find a female lounging on one, but so far no luck. Now Jamie has challenged us to an anecdotal safari, which is quite difficult, much more difficult than the challenge I was expecting on this sunset safari. Oh, hello. Oh, no, he's not hanging around either. Unfortunately, an impala disappeared at high speed. So if you are wondering anything about the African bush and would like to ask me about it, please feel free. You can do that by sending me an email on questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. It is a very interesting afternoon in terms of if we look at the light is incredibly harsh, and there's a big fire, I would say, to the south of us that's blowing in this hazy weather we've got now, combined with all the dust. It's giving us a very airy light. Oh, hello, kudus. Two little kudus. There's quite a lot of kudus around, but those two little ones. Giving us a good look. It's also quite windy, which means quite a lot of the animals are going to be a little bit jumpy, as the wind might mask the approach of a predator. Oh, big group of kudus. 1, 2, 3, 4 youngsters. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 adults around. One very big bull who's looking very interested in a female just to the left of us. Roll back a little bit. There he is. Oh, it looks like he might be doing the Fleming grimace. Now, an anecdote about Fleming grimace is you just have to watch this morning's sunrise safari and see James Henry's impression of a Fleming grimace. It's enough to make you cry with laughter. Nice big adult kudu bull. Possible one of the females is going to be coming into estrus, and he's keeping on her trail. No, he's still walking. I'm just going to try and get quite a bit ahead of them. Looks like he's going to cross the road. There we go. Beautiful big bull, and he's off after the lady who got a bit far from him. Now, I think out of the families of antelopes we get here in Africa, the Trafalagus family is my favorite, and that's the spiral horned antelope. Of all of them, bushbuck is my favorite, but kudu are also quite spectacular. I think one of the really wonderful things for me about the whole family is their scientific names have such awesome little stories that go along with it. So this is the greater kudu, and he's a particularly nice big boy, and he's a Trafalagus strepsiceros is his Latin name. And so it comes from streps, strepo, and keris. Keris is Greek for the horn of the animal, and strepo is twist. So for those incredibly big corkscrew twists is what the kudu gets its scientific name from. Strephus, twisting, beautiful, beautiful antelope. Now, as I said, they're sort of my favorites, the family of antelopes that are the spiral horned antelopes. Bushbuck is my personal be-all favorite antelope, I think. I really love those little creatures. And their Latin name is Trafalagus, which refers to their spiral horns. Scriptus, the one who has been written or drawn on. And that scientific name actually comes from the original Zulu word for bushbuck, mbabala, the one who has been written on or drawn on, and they've got the beautiful, dainty little spots that looks like someone's popped them on them. And then, of course, there's the Enyala, who's the spiral horned, I don't know. So he's Trafalagus angazi. When first discovered by Europeans, there was a Scotsman who headed up from around modern-day Durban today, and he took all his porters and staff on his expedition from that area. And Inyala didn't traditionally occur south of the Tugela River, so he got up into Zululand and he shot this animal, and he went to his staff and said, well, what is it? And they went, angaz. So he called it an angaz animal. So it's an I don't know, but of course the actual Zulu word from the Zulus who live further north for Inyala is Inyala. So two of the common names for antelope we see regularly out here, Impala and Inyala, are the exact same as the Zulu. So, speaking about the Impala, who is named, has stayed true since the Zulu days, Jamie's got some to show you.
Actually got a lovely mixed herd here of bachelor impala along with a couple of kudu from our side as well. And again, trying to choose my favorite anecdote about kudu is surprisingly tricky. Had so many incredible sightings of them. Once one jumped over the front bonnet of my personal vehicle whilst I was driving along a dirt road. That was terrifying, but that was not the anecdote I wanted to tell. The very first time, I know, here we go, I've got a connection for you and a story I don't think I've told before. I used to work in the Kalahari, and in the southern Kalahari, in the green Kalahari, the flies there, they're nicknamed horse flies. They're not actually technically horse flies as we know them, but they have incredibly powerful mouth parts that they bite onto you and then settle there for the rest of well, for as long as they can, until you find them, and you have to kind of like a tick. That Nyala just jumped over an impala. She really did. Just casually, like it was nothing. She just hopped over an impala. That's a first for me. I don't think I've ever seen a kudu jump over an impala before. Maybe they're going to start playing leapfrog. It'd be highly entertaining. Anyway, to distract myself and change the subject, let me go forward a bit while I do so that you can see the bull of this particular group. Kudu are connected, very closely connected in my mind, to the first time that I ever did game capture, proper game capture in the Kalahari. Now, basically what I mean by that is that we were capturing animals. The private conservation industry in South Africa is something that has absolutely ballooned and blossomed. And there are lots of budding game reserves that have started up, which is of course wonderful for conservation efforts. But that does mean that they have to be populated with animals and the genetic stock kept nice and fresh. So I was participating in capturing a number of kudu through ketamine and M99 darts and then moving them into a truck and then moving them to their new homes elsewhere, essentially repopulating areas where man had either through habitat encroachment or through hunting or through poaching, whatever else, essentially remove the natural species that lived there. And the first time I ever got to inject an animal, a wild animal, I'd spent a lot of time in vet surgeries when I was younger, but a wild animal, was on a kudu where I was allowed to administer its sedative and its vit. They give all of them vitamin shots. Well, they did in this particular instance, so I got to give him his vitamin shots as well. It was a truly extraordinary experience because it was a whole load of us picking up a kudu on a tarpaulin and putting it in the back of the vehicle to transport it to the crates. And the reason that the horseflies came into that story was because I very quickly learned that as glamorous as a job like that might seem, you end up bruised, battered, and covered in these horseflies in places that they should never have managed to reach. You don't know how they managed to reach it. You spend your evenings removing them from your skin. And this particular kudu was covered in them. So another thing that they used to do as part of the capture process was actually spray them with insecticide to get rid of, not a heavy-duty insecticide, but essentially an anti-tick and an anti-parasite spray, just so that they were a bit more comfortable when they arrived in their new homes. It was a very interesting lesson that. We did roan that day. It was the first time. No, that's not true. It was the first time I ever saw an aardwolf in the Kalahari was on that day. An aardwolf, of course, is an animal that if we saw here, and in theory we could, I would be absolutely beside myself with excitement. It's the smallest member of the hyena family, arguable, but it is classified as the smallest member of the hyena family, and an pure insectivore, so it doesn't have those big bone-crushing jaws. And that is an animal that I would love to see. Our kudu have moved off and we need to carry on towards Cheetah Plains. Let's go and see if we can't get Viam another spotted cat to film, since we could not, unfortunately, stay with Tundi. No matter what we did, the signal just didn't come back. It's very common to see mixed herds of antelope like that. More eyes means less chance of a predator sneaking up on them. But then at the same time, they're just comfortable in each other's presence and they're of no threat to each other. So we had a group of feeders there, the impala munching on grass shoots as well as leaves. But Chris, you were wondering, what do the kudu eat? And the answer is they are browsers, with very, very limited exceptions. Sometimes they might nibble on a fresh green grass shoot, or maybe a particular type of perennial plant that they might smells nutritious. But in general, they are adapted for browsing, and they tend to be quite focused on, they're quite adaptable in terms of what they can eat. So they'll focus on bush willows, and then they'll go across. They tend to ignore the sickle bush. I haven't seen that. In fact, it's only really elephants that will properly eat sickle bush. What you got there, Via? Lion tracks. I was told that there were lion tracks coming in this direction. That's why we're going here. This is good news for all involved. Unfortunately, because this is the main access road to the lodge, they have been driven over, but I'll keep an eye out for a nice one to show you all. Oh, sorry, Chris. Yes, I was talking about kudu and their feeding habits. They'll nibble on pretty much anything, and as we go further and further into this drought, they will have to continue to nibble further or eat, be less fussy in terms of what they eat. The interesting thing, of course, is that while you watch them do that, you'll watch them moving into the wind in order to avoid the tannins that a plant starts to produce as soon as it's fed on. So they'll feed into the wind so that the leaves are not bitter tasting and horrible for them to eat. We're going to go through another signal dip. While we do that, let's head over to Brent and see if he can give us some more lovely anecdotes.
Look at this, guys. We've found some eddies. I'm going to be with you in a second. Sorry, Tax, go again. Look at the floppy ear there. A long time before. I haven't checked the kayas for about 5 days. Sorry about that. As we linked, Taxon was just asking me if we had seen the hyenas and which den was active. And we think they've moved in. We haven't managed to find it, but while we're with the elephants. So look at that. Oh, his ear's very floppy. It's a young male. Now, it's probably cartilage damage. So an elephant's ear is a very big piece of cartilage, and that's what keeps it stiff. So when you see it flopping like that, there's a sort of a break or a bend in the cartilage. It doesn't really affect them too much, and you can still see the blood vessels there, and is still able to flap it a bit to help them cool down, and not such a stress in winter because it is quite nippy even now already. Very cold wind we have this evening. Oh, I keep forgetting about this anecdote, and Final Control keeps reminding me. Now, I've had quite a lot of little elephant anecdotes, fortunately. I've been very lucky, spent lots of time with them. I think probably I've quite a special one. I was about 12 or 13, and we were living in a tent up on the Quando River in northern Botswana. And I've got a big tent. And had gauze windows. Woke up at about 3 o'clock in the morning with an elephant bull sniffing so much it was actually pulling my hair. So I woke up with this, and it was an elephant sniffing me through the window of the tent. Nice young eddies. Now there's more than likely a big breeding herd behind in that block, and these boys have probably become just a little bit too rambunctious, and they've been pushed to the peripheries of the herd. So probably 14, 15-ish. Naughty boys. Terrible teens. Can be so peaceful, also playful, and at the moment they're very focused on feeding. Now, the majority of an elephant's life centers around feeding. Those massive frames, they have to eat for the majority of the day and night to keep themselves sustained. Well, Lynn says that floppy ear really makes that elephant look sad. Well, he looks quite happy to me. If you watch his tail and his body language, he doesn't seem to be too perturbed with his floppy ear. Now, if any of you are watching the sunrise safari, we had a very entertaining little moment with an elephant bull about this age. He was playing soccer with a clod of clay. And Catherine's just saying that Ellie Bull was very cute. And I agree wholeheartedly, Catherine. It was one of the more entertaining sightings I've had in the last while. And showed some serious skill. Who knows, maybe some of the international teams will be getting an elephant. Well, apart from its skill, I just think the sheer terror of running onto a soccer field playing against an elephant would immediately lead you to win the game. Now you see, that's the second bull. He's feeding off a buffalo thorn that's already been pushed off. And they're really having to work hard to get enough sustenance at the moment. And you'll be noticing they're probably going to be feeding for a lot longer during the day and night. We're going to be hearing them moving around, especially if you're listening to the dam cam. You'll probably hear them quite a bit more during the night now. So, if we have a look at Mr. Floppy there, Rachel's wondering if that's going to sort of negatively affect his hearing. Rachel, it probably will. Nothing too grand. The elephant's hearing is very good, but the ear is flopping over the actual ear hole, and also that big wide ear helps amplify the sound, which that's not going to happen. So, you'll definitely find his right-hand side is far better than his left. But I want to see if I can catch up with the rest of the breeding herd, which I think is probably moving through the block. And at the same time, James Richard will be very happy to know I'll check out for those jackals. Okay, let's get going. So Raisa is posing a very interesting question when it comes to elephant herd dynamics. Raisa is asking if a herd has a really young matriarch, would other elephants leave that group and join a herd with an older matriarch? I don't think so. So when you see elephants like that, they're actually little individual family groups. And there will be some movement between that. But I think generally it's unusual to have a young matriarch. Almost always the matriarch will be quite old. And it is possible that they might join an aunt or something. But you don't really find young matriarchs in my experience. So definitely something to probably read into and research a bit more. And that's what I love about what we do, is you learn something new every day. And we've got such a great team because we constantly push each other to learn more. And what's it, to quote Kirsten from Final Control's saying, and it's actually become a camp saying, just be better. So we try to be better every day. So this is a good spot. We're going to look out for those little side-striped jackals that James Richard was asking about. They have been seen. Oh, got both of them. There we go. They're also not enjoying this cool wind. Let me just go back a little bit so we can see both. And it looks like they have set up shop from Impala Plains. I mean, not Impala Plains, from the sandy patch. Oh, I don't know if you're picking that up on the mic, are you? That massive herd of elephants is off to the right. But now, before I forget, an anecdote about side-striped jackal. I remember one from my younger years. So, as a lot of our regular viewers will know that, Ellie's having big conversation behind us. We can't see them then. I was very fortunate. I've grown up in the bush my whole life, and my father is one of the founders of a company that is now known as And Beyond. It used to be called Conservation Corporation Africa. And he was the director on site at Pinda Private Game Reserve. So some of my formative years were spent living in the middle of the reserve. And for those of you not sure, Pinda was a bunch of mostly cattle farms that we bought and put together and turned into an amazing wildlife reserve now. So a lot of animals had to be brought in. And side-striped jackal was one of them. And we had dogs while we were growing up, and they lived with us, of course. And the one night, our Rottweiler cross Labrador was barking, and we'd just released side-striped jackal around the house, and we assumed it was barking at a side-striped jackal, and because it had been for about the week before, and the jackal sort of just stayed outside off the veranda. And my dad, in his pajamas, ran out to chase the jackal to get the dog to keep quiet. And he nearly ran flat into a hippo. The dog was barking at a hippopotamus, not a jackal. But we were very lucky. Those jackals set up territory right around our house, and we got to see a lot of them. And fortunately, eventually the dogs got used to them and stopped barking at them as well. Yeah, well, let's see if we can catch up with that elephant herd that was making all that noise. So while we go look for one of the biggest beasts out in Africa, Jamie's got, well, the second smallest antelope that could possibly occur here.
There he goes. Sorry. I did have to have a good chuckle at that one. That Stenbok stood frozen perfectly right up until Brent sent you across here, at which point it decided to dash away. Now, that was a little male Stenbok. When I first encountered him, he was standing very much with his head in a buffalo thorn, which didn't look very comfortable at all. Most of you know, we've told you plenty of stories about our experiences with the buffalo thorn and the impact that it has, but there we go, here's an anecdote for you about buffalo thorns. I'll find you a nice one. Those ones are a little bit far away, but I'll find you a nice buffalo thorn. But as part of our sighting anecdotes, a buffalo thorn has two very sharp sets of paired thorns. So it's got one straight one that points straight away from the plant and one hooked one. Now that is exceptionally uncomfortable when encountered. The thorns are so sharp that no matter how small your encounter with them might be, they're very determined to hook into your skin. Now, one of the things that I used to do where I worked before I started working here was twice a week we would go and we would, because it was an area that had previously been used as farmland, it had a lot of encroached vegetation. What I mean by that is because it had been treated as a farm, they were actually farms given to returning World War II soldiers, strangely enough, and they were just handed these parcels of land. And as a result, through grazing cattle, they became exceptionally overgrazed, and therefore we got bush encroachment from species like buffalo thorn, sickle bush, spike thorn, all kinds of things. So what we used to do twice a week was we'd go and we'd construct clearings, and we'd go and we'd clear bushes. We'd also clear roads at the same time, just to make some nice areas that would have existed anyway for the bulk grazers, such as the buffalo or the zebra or whatever else happened to come along and enjoy those open areas. So that's what we used to do. And thinking back on it now, we did arm a lot of people with very little experience with things like pangas, which is the equivalent of a South African machete. We carry them in our cars at some point, and saws and all kinds, all manner of dangerous things. And as you can expect, sometimes things went somewhat wrong. And in this particular case, it concerned a buffalo thorn and my head. Because the very sweet volunteer that we had, she was got very committed and very into the process of cutting down this buffalo thorn, that she forgot to warn poor old me, who was sitting on the other side of it, busy, I can't remember what I was doing, I might even have just been tying my shoelace, but she forgot to tell me at the point at which it came down on my head, and it took a considerable period of time to help me out and help clear me. Oh, there's a warthog. Wait, warthogs, don't go. Trotting off into the distance. The reason I said oh in that tone of surprise and interrupted what was obviously an enthralling buffalo thorn story, and one which we've all experienced at some point or another. I did have an amazing scar, just by the way, down the center of my left eye. I really looked like Scar from The Lion King. It's gone now, but it was quite impressive. The reason I said oh is they're pumping the pan again. Three in the row pan is now one pan that has some water in it. And they've decided clearly that I think they've finished fixing the pans up, and they are now starting to supply water. Now for any new viewers who have joined us for the first, oh, look at that. On cue, coming to have a drink, smelling the fresh water. Hello. That was perfect timing. Oh, little one. What I was going to say is, if you are new and joining us for the first time, we are going into a drought. A very serious drought. And the animals, or the various game reserves, are actually providing with the animals with places to come and drink. Look at that. That older female at the back is very clearly the oldest and most experienced elephant in this little herd. Oh, so exciting. Fresh, clean water. It's been freshly pumped. The elephants are going to absolutely love this. Oh, little one trying to find its way around the wall. Got a one-tusked female at the back, coming to join the rest of her family. Small little herd. Probably lost her tusk in some way. It broke off. I don't quite know exactly what would have happened there. She's pushing her way in. And as is to be expected, they've headed to the side of the dam where the water is coming in from, so where they know that the water will be at its freshest. I'm just going to be quiet for a moment so that you can hear the slurping sounds as they drink. It's a little bit windy for this, but we'll try. Ah, as I said that, the wind started howling. To drink its fill. It was great fun watching a baby elephant drink because they haven't quite got that adult coordination and control over their trunks just yet. But the process sometimes takes a little bit longer than it might normally, or it might take an adult elephant. I'm just adjusting some layers here. It's a bit chilly. Apparently I've been muffling my lapel mic in my attempt to keep warm, my apologies. As we watch our elephants use their incredible trunks, I hear that you were with the floppy-eared elephant with Brent a little while ago. And Fiona, you were wondering if we've ever encountered an elephant with floppy trunk syndrome. And I've never seen it in the wild, I have to be honest. I've never seen it out here. I'm not entirely sure it even naturally occurs out here. I mean, floppy trunks, babies are a perfect example because they haven't got that coordination yet. As you can see, this little one is having a real struggle here. That patch. Oh, there we go, maybe a little bit, that was okay. A bit more? No? That's not going to help. That's going to make it even muddier. You're sinking your trunk right into the mud. It's going to make it so disgusting. Now you're just having fun. Now you're just playing. It's like a toddler in the bath blowing bubbles. You better drink quickly, little one. Your family won't hang around. And Fiona, I have to confess that floppy trunks is not something that I know very much about when it comes to our elephant. So whilst I'm saying that I haven't seen it before, that's not to say that it doesn't occur. The only time I've ever seen floppy trunks is with little baby elephants. But I will definitely be looking into it and finding out if any such thing happens. Of course, we do get our snared trunk elephants, or elephants that have lost their trunks to crocodiles. The female with the three-quarter trunk is one of my favorite, as well as that bull that we started seeing over the last few weeks with only maybe even less than half a trunk. It's not hard here to see who is in charge and is in control. Most of these elephants are very, very young, only just at their oldest entering their teens. And that little one is probably around two, maybe. But you can see the big female at the back stands far taller than the rest of them. She's clearly much, much older. Haha. You're a clever little boy, you. Do you discover where the water comes out exactly? Are you going to go and dig it up? I'm thinking about it. Now, Alyssa, on the subject of our pumped pans, you were wondering, do they pump more in winter? Or because the evaporation might not be as serious? or do they? Is it the same in summer and in winter? It's a difficult one. So usually, in a normal year, they would not even have to dream of pumping these water holes, or these water points, in summer, because that, of course, is our rainy season. So they'll get extraordinary amounts of rain. These pans would probably be full to the point of overflowing in a normal year. Unfortunately, this year has been somewhat different, as was the year before, and they did pump regularly in summer, and they would have had to have pumped more. Particularly, we went through that terrible patch in January, where all of the dams were dry, and it was so, so hot. Oh, somebody climbing up onto the wall. Never fails to amaze me how coordinated elephants can be, and I think the Ellie calf might even think about imitating her older cousin, older male cousin. Oh, that little sideways tilt of the head from the female there said it all. It was a very gentle rebuke from her to those two young males, telling them to behave themselves. Just a little sideways tilt. They did pump the dam, or continue to pump the pan. Hello. You're so cute. Throughout that summer period, but the days were well over 100 degrees every single day, and there was a huge amount of evaporation that was happening there, and just nothing that anybody could do about it. And of course, these dams, at some point before the influx of human beings to this area, these dams did not exist. They have been put there artificially. But this drought is one of the worst that has ever been recorded. It's not necessarily the worst ever that we've ever had, but it is the worst that's ever been recorded. Oh! For those of you who are viewers in Durban, I don't know if any of you are watching at the moment. Now, we tend not to look at the weather reports unless it's happening that day. Is there something on its way? Is there something we should know about our weather? Is there a nice cold front that's making its way from the south towards us? Because it's suddenly dropped so many degrees. Oh, and I'm sorry, I'm going to have to drag you back as the wind howls. Just because baby's about to stick his head, or he was sticking his head right into the mud. Are you having fun? Is that mud fun? You're not meant to eat the mud. It's the water you want. Oh, but I'm going to eat the mud. That's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to eat the mud because I'm a baby and therefore I can. I can do strange things like that. Even if it doesn't taste very nice, I'm enjoying it. Mmm, yum. So, geophagy is actually not uncommon, and you might find that this thick clay does actually have some minerals or salts that this little baby is enjoying, because something is telling it to eat dirt and enjoy the mud. And since this pan has been dry for a long time, you might even find that it's enriched the top layer of the clay layer, and that's why the elephant baby is eating it. None of the others seem terribly interested. Maybe one male at the back looks like he might be doing it as well. Oh no, they are. They are all doing it. The young males are doing it as well. So this is geophagy. There's something nice in the clay from this dam. Maybe because it has been dug a little bit, it's been dug up a bit and deepened. So that might have exposed something, a layer of clay that has a particular mineral that they are enjoying. They are munching away at it. And the plants around the edges, of course. Hello, Linda. talking about our trunk. You've been watching our little one use its trunk. And you were wondering, can elephants get colds or stuffy noses, anything that sort of blocks up their trunk? Not in the same way necessarily that we do. However, they can get infections and cuts and sores and blocked up sinuses in their trunks, just like we do. It's not all that common, but it can happen. I mean, that epithelial layer that runs along the inside of the trunk is tougher than ours, but still, it's an epithelial layer. It's a thin layer of skin cells that automatically becomes sensitive. However, at the tip of the trunk, the sort of the first few inches of trunk, are filled with exceptionally thick bristly hairs that basically serve the same function as our nose hairs do, in terms of, but even more so, even more importantly. Oh, don't break their wall, little one. They've just spent all that time fixing it for you. Yes, those thick bristly layers helping to keep any foreign particles from lodging too far up the trunk. Cute. Love watching the interactions. The two bulls, knowing that they must definitely behave themselves with this young male calf, or they will be in serious trouble. But they do want to scuffle with each other. The little one wants to join in too. Wants to be part of the fun. If you guys won't let me play, then I'm just going to stick my trunk in your mouth. Kick dirt, because you won't let me play with you. Fine. These two squaring up, playing King of the Castle. And the baby looking in serious danger of being knocked over at this point. But that astoundingly hardly ever happens with elephants, despite their enormous bulk and their numerous blind spots. They very seldom bash into or knock the babies unless they mean to. It doesn't really happen by mistake. That quick trunk into the mouth greeting that the younger calf gave, I sort of jokingly said it was because they wouldn't let him play, but actually all elephants do that. It's the part of the elephant that is one of the strongest smelling. And so they stick their nose in there as partly a tactile conversation, then also as a way of smelling what's happening with that particular elephant, since they do communicate through smell as well as sound. All congregating around this damn wall. Fascinating. But I haven't seen them eating any more dirt now, actively. This is amazing. This little one's now got his mouth on the dirt. I can't tell if that's his head, if it's because his head's been pushed into the dirt, or if he's actively trying to eat. Aww. Something's got them very interested there. And I'm sure it's the freshly dug soil of the dam wall. Not digging. I haven't been eating that much. No, look, he is licking it. He's licking the dirt. There you go. Geophagy at work. Practice of eating dirt, or at least the soil. Amazing. Little one's got prime position, although I do still feel as though there's a chance it could go tumbling into the water hole. I love sitting with elephants and just enjoying their sheer intelligence. At Monique in London, You were wondering if elephants would be clever enough to water the ground in order to provide for some fresh grass or anything like that. And the answer is no, unfortunately not. And whilst they are the instinctive farmers of an area, that they keep particularly bush encroachment species like round-leafed teaks at a specific size rather than letting them get too large, they're not farmers to that extent, so they won't have any understanding. And of course, in a normal season, they don't need to, regardless, because the annual grasses and the perennial grasses are, their growth is based off the yearly rain patterns, but also the length of the day. So even if they watered the grass now, it wouldn't grow at all until the start of next summer. And just like that, off they go. Wander off. Now, I've completely forgotten all about my anecdotal story. I'll save one up for the elephants for another time. In the meantime, Brent has got a lapwing chick and he must have a good anecdote about lapwings.
So we've got a pair of crowned lapwings, and if you look very carefully to the one on the left, there's a tiny, tiny little chick. Here it is, pecking on the ground, following around the adults. Isn't that just too cute? More than a day or two at most old, and you can see they're not the only inhabitants of Impala Plains at the moment. And interestingly enough, I've seen lapwings attack elephants when they have chicks or nests. So if those elephants meander too far towards the baby, they will harass the elephant. So we didn't make it to Arethusa due to the fact that there was not much happening there, and we were listening for this big herd of eddies. Now, again, I forget the anecdote that we lost an anecdote. Oh, we could get some fun. We could make a new anecdote right here. But as I was saying, my anecdote was that I've watched lapwings dive bomb elephants on many occasions. Now, normally when they're still nesting, but let's see what happens. Oh, there's another floppy-eared elephant in the background. Where's the baby? Did he run off?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
No dive bombing, no making of new anecdotes today. A young bull walking towards us. It's actually quite a big herd that are spreading out. It's the herd we've been waiting for to come out of the thick block. And while we were waiting for them, Herbert actually spotted that baby lapwing. So the rest of the herd are coming through around the back of us. I'm going to just reverse a bit more. And I did see a bit earlier through the trees a really big bull that was with them as well. I'm hoping we get a nice view of him. The rest of the herd. It's spread out through the bush here. That one's the most open at the moment. They are all over the place. Hello, mister. Oh, careful if you eat that. That little bush he's eating there. Let me just have a quick look if we zoom a bit closer. It is too. It's call the hairy caterpillar bush. And that is the traditional medicine version of the little blue pill. And he's a bit young to be chasing the ladies. There's a little baby that I'm hoping is going to approach us. And it looks like it's full of mischief. He's just behind the gwarry bush there. You can just see, look at that. There's naughtiness written on that face. I'm up for, there we go. Okay. You can spot them. Those naughty little ones. He's like, ooh, they look fun to play with. I'm going to stalk them and I'm just charge them and show them how tough I am. Everybody comes close to the car. Oh, he's going to hide behind Mom. Will he charge from the front? Hello, naughty. Naughty, naughty. No. I can't believe we didn't get sorted out. I was really expecting a good sorting out from that little chap. Maybe he's going to approach from the other side. Oh, two in front of us, Brian. They look like they're up to something. Oh, no. There's so much focus on feeding at the moment. And I think in the late afternoon, there is the focus on feeding. We tend to get a bit more playfulness in the early morning. And of course, the ones that are young enough still to be suckling are still full of nonsense, but they're not relying on having to feed themselves just yet. You can see how hazy the light is through the sun there. It should make for quite a spectacular sunset later. Oh, there goes the tree. Bush architects rearranging their surrounds. James Richard said I should toss him a soccer ball. He's probably bored. Yes, very good, James. James is referring to a sighting he had this morning of a young bull kicking around a clay ball like a soccer ball, and he did so for quite a bit of time. Oh, very pretty, Brian. Nice camera work.
Thank you.
Very, very beautiful. Using the hazy light to give a ethereal glow to the elephants. We've got very clever cameramen. Some more young bulls coming through. Oh, let's just reverse a little bit. I'm just trying to see where the next load are going to come through at. Caroline is wondering, how do elephants communicate with each other? Just trying to find you a little window How's that, Brian?